If you have restless leg syndrome and want to find out more about this condition with the very best and latest evidence-based advice, this video is for you. My name is Simon and I'm a consultant in clinical neurophysiology. I'm going to explain to you what we now know about this common condition and how best to manage it. Restless leg syndrome, or RLS, is very common and affects at least 2% of the population. It is a clinical diagnosis which was redefined in 2014 as matching five key criteria. Number one, an urge to move the legs, which is usually accompanied by an unpleasant sensation in the legs too. This is often described as a crawling sensation under the skin, much as if there were creepy crawlies underneath it. Two, it is worse during periods of rest or inactivity. Three, there is at least partial relief by movement. Four, clear evening or nighttime emphasis. And five, it is not solely explained by another medical or behavioural condition. When it comes to understanding and therefore treating RLS, there are two major categories, primary and secondary. Let's start with secondary RLS. This means that there is an identifiable process driving the RLS, and if so, treatment is aimed at addressing the underlying cause as well as managing symptoms. Causes can include any of the following: peripheral neuropathy in around one third of patients. This may be a large fibre or more commonly a small fibre neuropathy. You can see separate videos explaining these and how they are tested by clinical neurophysiologists such as myself by clicking on the iCards above. Iron and to a much lesser extent magnesium deficiency can also be causes, raised urea levels from kidney failure and varicose veins too. Medications can include a variety of antidepressants as well as antihistamines, which can be factors. Pregnancy is also well recognised but self-resolved afterwards in the vast majority of cases. Primary RLS is where there is no identifiable cause. It's quite different in that it tends to start at a much younger age, far more insidiously, and there is often a positive family history in around two-thirds of patients. Therefore, research is ongoing into a variety of potential causative genes. To understand how treatment works and why it can fail, we need to understand and be clear on the underlying disease mechanisms. Current research has identified that multiple regions of the brain dysfunction, especially the basal ganglia, which are important in initiating and controlling movements. Many of the neural cells here rely on dopamine, which needs iron as part of its formation. Iron uptake by these cells is impaired in RLS for reasons as yet unknown. This leads to a relative fall in dopamine production. So we can target either one of these. So patients who are iron deficient, and this can be from any cause of anemia, can respond well to iron replacement therapy. We can also give medications that either increase dopamine levels directly, such as levodopa, or act like dopamine, such as ropinirole, which are also successfully used as treatments for this condition. However, it's not just these cells that dysfunction. It's also important to recognise that the brain's natural internal opioid system may also be depleted, and this may be the reason why this condition is often quite responsive to opioid medications too. Many other structures which govern sensation, emotion, cognition, behaviour and movements are also implicated as well. This likely explains why so many patients have a multitude of other problems, including high rates of depression in up to 30%, impulsivity, and problems with decision making. Sleep disturbances are also very common. Around 80% of RLS patients have periodic leg movements in sleep, which are associated with arousal, and so further interrupt sleep quality too. This is a long-term condition, and whilst it can wax and wane and sometimes go into remission, treatment often needs to be provided for prolonged periods of time, even many years. There is a significant issue with dopamine replacement therapy, which is called augmentation. This means that the treatment itself can in fact worsen the condition, with the risk of this happening at around 7-8% per year. Signs of this developing include worsening intensity, spread of symptoms into other body regions such as the arms, shorter duration between rest and symptom onset, and also rolling back of earlier onset of symptoms into the daytime too. Some medications are worse at doing this than others, particularly levodopa. This is why it is no longer a first choice treatment. the combined task forces of the RLS Foundation, the European RLS Study Group, and the International RLS Study Group have produced their management recommendations and guidelines in 2016. You can find a link to the whole guidance in the description box below, but briefly to summarise their primary recommendations. Number one, non-dopamine medications such as gabapentin and acarbil, also called Horizant, should be trialled first, which should hopefully avoid the risk of augmentation. However, it has not yet universally been licensed as a first-line medication. Two, when dopaminergic medications are utilised, these should be at the lowest possible doses, for example, pramipexole, ropinirole or retigotine, and should also be with an aim to reduce symptoms to the point where the quality of life isn't so impaired, but not that they are completely eradicated. Three, if augmentation does occur, then anything exacerbating it should be addressed, such as iron replacement therapy if patients have low iron stores, or avoidance of any medications that are known to exacerbate augmentation, such as antidepressants or antihistamines, which should be reduced or avoided as much as possible. And of course, any lifestyle factors such as sleep deprivation need to be addressed, or anything medically exacerbating it, such as obstructive sleep apnea. Four, other medications may need to be added at this point, such as Horizant or even switching. Five, opioids such as oxycodone do have a place in treatment, but are reserved for those with severe augmentation symptoms not responding to all other means. I hope that you have found this video useful, and if so, please do support this channel and my work by liking, subscribing, and sharing. Thank you so much for your support, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video.